The title is nothing but the blood, the blood, the blood. The blood of Jesus, the most important really thing that we have available to us at the moment, and what it's done to our lives. So, good. So, are you in John chapter 20 yet? All right. So, in Matthew 26, 28, we always, don't go there, but we always use that scripture for communion, right? Because of the cup, he says, in this cup is remission of sin. And the blood of Jesus is probably, again, I said, the most important thing. And in John chapter 20, one of the things that we see Jesus do, the first order of business, John chapter 20, verse 14, sorry, John 20, 14, I know Sharon can get it up on the screen. One of the first order of business that Jesus needed to take care of is present his blood into heaven, into the throne room. And it says here, now when she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there and did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking? She supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away. Jesus said to her, Mary. She turned and said to him, Rabboni, which is to say teacher. Jesus said to her, do not cling to me or do not touch me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren and say to them, I am ascending to my Father, your Father, and to my God and your God. So the reason why he said don't touch me is because the very first order of business, the very first thing Jesus needed to take care of is present his body and his blood specifically into the throne room and pour it out on the mercy seat of God. And because of the blood, God has done such, it's changed humanity. God had required a blood sacrifice from the very beginning, right? And he talked the Jews that. And if you go all the way back to the book of Genesis, one of the things that took place in the book of Genesis is when Adam and Eve sinned, they tried to cover their sins, right? How did they do that? They took fig leaves, right? They made fig leaves and they made clothes out of them. And, you know, and they created their first religion that was ever created, the Church of the Fig Leaf, started right then and there. First Baptist Corner Church of the Fig Leaf. So on Mount Zion, something. Anyway, so what God did is he came and he showed them, you can't cover your sins, only I can. And so what he did is he sacrificed an animal, probably a lamb, because we see the lamb throughout Scripture. He sacrificed an animal. And he took the skins from the animal and he made clothes for them. So there was a shedding of blood at that point. And so because of that, the only way we could approach God is by the shedding of blood. Without blood, we can never approach God. And because of sin, sin caused that, caused blood to be evident, blood to be a part of our lives and part of our reconciliation with God. Now we know, right, Leviticus, I believe, is 11:17 or 17:11. Sometimes I'm dyslexic because I'm a genius, right? So it says that the life of the flesh is in the blood, correct? So your body can't survive without blood. There's so much in your blood that creates life, so to speak. And in your blood, if you ever notice, if they take your blood, you find everything about you in your blood, everything. Your whole history. They can go back and tell you you've had chicken pox when you were 5. They can find anything about you. And if you go to any doctor's office, they always take blood before a physical because they could tell, they can do sheets and sheets of reports about you and your blood. You know, Janice and I today are going over to the doctor's office to get our antibodies tested to see how much and, you know, so we can donate. And I know mine are going to be super strong, right? So... and so they can tell if you've had COVID by the antibodies that are in your blood because of your blood. So the blood is extremely important and it's important to God. Now notice here, the very first thing Jesus needed to do is present his blood to heaven. Good? So I wanted to say this. The blood, God is always, the blood of Jesus is always before God the Father. He He can't look at anything without seeing the blood, because it's forever in his face, the blood. If it's forever in his face, it's physically in heaven right now. The blood ever lives, it says. It's alive. His blood is alive. It's without sin. It's perfect. And God is forever in view of the blood of Jesus that was shed for mankind. So if it's always in his view, it must always be in our view. Really, for us to step out as a Christian, so to speak, we need to understand the purpose of the blood. And if it's always in God's view, it must be in our view. How? We can't see it, but by faith, we know it. We need to speak about it. We need to think about it. We need to sing about it. It has to be by faith that we are always thinking about the blood. If you're blood conscious, you won't be sin conscious. If you're always thinking about the beauty and the purpose and the wonder working of the blood, you won't be thinking about how bad you are, how sinful you are, how shameful you are, how guilty you are, how condemned you are. When you think about what God did because of the blood, you won't worry about what you did because of your weaknesses and your infirmities and your sin. Because the blood will make you think differently about yourself, people around you, and life itself. And God does that. God doesn't see you as a no good sinner. He sees you as a blood bought, washed Christian, redeemed, saved, delivered, changed, his child. And if he sees that, we should see that as well. And we fail in life because we don't understand the power of the blood. There's tremendous power in the blood of Jesus. Satan hates any talk about the blood. He hates any mention of it. He hates anything that you think about when it's about the blood. He just hates it. But for us, it's life. Amen? So go to Isaiah 43 now. Isaiah 43. So let me ask you a question. If you know that God dealt with your sin once and for all, removed it from you, then why are we always talking about the opposite? Why are we always talking about sin when we should really talk about the wonderful blood of Jesus? Now, there is a place for talking about sin. But if you're always talking about it, thinking about it, singing about it, how wretched you are, you'll never move to the place that God says, no, you're my child. You're a new creature in Christ. Behold, all things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. So Isaiah 43, verse 25, ready? It says this, Isaiah 43, yes, 25. It says, I am he who blots out your transgressions for your own sake, and I will not remember your sins. I want you to notice what that scripture says. God says this, that he blots out your sins and he will remember them no more. Now, I want you to understand, when God says, I'll blot them out and I won't remember them, it doesn't mean that God suffers from short-term memory loss. It doesn't mean that God suffers from amnesia. It doesn't mean that God's like, oh yeah, I forgot, I got so much going on, I got so much on my mind. You know, I mean, Lewis just blew me away. He raised $500 and I forgot about your sin, Spiro. I just completely forgot about it. No, it's not like God is not so overwhelmed. He's not so stressed out that he forgets about our sin. He literally forgets them. Amen. So how many of you agree that God is the strongest mind in the world? Amen. He's the brain. I mean, he's got nuclear powered brain, right? I mean, he's better than he ever read a bunny. He'll never run out of power, right? He is power. And so God's brain is so amazing, so powerful. I mean, he created everything right from here. He just thought it, bam, it was done, right? So if this huge, the brain of the universe can say, I forget, if he has the power to forget, how much more we should forget as well? How much more should we not remember our sins or the guy sitting next to you's sins? Amen. Praise Jesus. Hallelujah. Now let me say, let me describe the word blot. The word blot here, it says to blot out your sin. Verse 25, he blots out your transgressions or blots out your sin. The word in Hebrew means to physically, by hand, destroy or eliminate and abolish and to wipe away every aspect of it. The word blot. So God says, he says, I blot out your sins, right, from you and remember them no more. He literally, physically goes and gets a hold of your sin and he rips it up and he burns and there's no evidence of it. So you can't take the paper and tape it again and say, here, I got it. No, he literally wipes it away. It's gone. God doesn't remember your sin. Think about that. God does not. He purposely forgets your sin. Purposely. Now, a couple of years ago, I got on the web because I heard about this, what is it called? Like, not police search, but look up your records, you know, like what you've done in your old life. So I put my name in, and sure enough, something came up. I'm like, wait a minute, I'm not that bad. You know, your police records, you know, that thing, you just type in something, search somebody's records, public records, and it came up from 1984. I was on my boat, and I got pulled over by the police just for a life preserver check, and I was short one life preserver, and I got a ticket for it. It is still on my record. Don't you think the chief should blot out that one instance because I was one life preserver short? Think about how the world treats you. They don't, 36 years later, the world has a record because I was one life preserver short. And they can always throw it in my face if they want. Sad, isn't it? Thank God he's God. Well, I can't thank God he's God. I mean, you know, that means there's another God, right? Thank God. Because he has no record of any wrongdoing you've ever done. If he did, he'd deny the blood of Jesus. Now, in order for me to get rid of that one life preserver short ticket, I'd have to hire a lawyer. And the lawyer would have to go to court and have something called expunge. He'd have to expunge my record. So in other words, he has to literally go to court before a judge, present my record, and says, judge, can you expunge this from Artie's record? And if the judge says yes, they would literally rip it up, take it out of the records books from every instance that it's ever occurred, and no one, listen, you'll never, ever find it again. There'll never be a record that I did. Well, there has to be. Nope, they won't be because it's legally removed in a court of law. The Bible says that Jesus is our advocate. And he went into the throne room with his blood and he says, Father, I am asking you in a court of law to remove every record of wrongdoing by all my children. All your children, I stand as their lawyer, and I'm asking you to expunge and blot out every occurrence that has ever happened to these people. How many of you ever seen my most favorite movie of all time? Anybody know it? Say it. My Cousin Vinny. My clock is ticking like this. Anyway, My Cousin Vinny. You know, the reason why it's my favorite, because I grew up with guys like that and girls like that that talk like that. You know, how's your Chinese food? So help me, Jesus. So Vinny Gambini, right? Have you remember the courtroom scene, right? The courtroom scene. Now, watch this. So... what? The two Utes?
No.
No. So in the courtroom, remember when Vinny, my cousin Vinny, right, puts the lady on the stand with the thick glasses, right? You know, lady got the thick glasses, right? And she says she saw two people, right? Two people, that those two guys are the guys that drove away. So he puts a tape, right? And he goes back 50 feet and he says, ma'am, he says, how many fingers do I have, right? And the judge says, let the record show that he has two fingers up. In other words, huh? Yeah, Your Honor, please. Think about what the judge just said. Put this in the record. Every single court case, every action that is taken, there's a record of it that's for life. Yes. So every time before you were in Christ, right, the devil went up and said, let the record show, God, that that person sinned. Brian sinned really bad. Let the record show. He thinks he's Batman. Let the record show. There is a record, the Bible says. It's called the books of works. It's in the book of Revelation. There are books of works. There are records of things you have done. Let the record show. One day you will stand, if you're not a Christian, if you're not born again, one day you will stand before the judge and he will say, what's your name? State your name. Where's your lawyer? I don't have one, sir. If you're in Christ, Jesus is your lawyer. And let me tell you something. Jesus has never lost a case. He is the greatest lawyer that has ever existed. See, because when he enters the courtroom and he goes up to the judge and he takes you with him, he says, Judge, Father. He immediately wins the case. It's over. But if you don't know God, if you don't know Christ, if you're not born again, if you're not saved, I can go through all the terminology, right? It's not about terminology. It's if Jesus is Lord of your life and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, that he died for you in your place. That's what I'm talking about. If that's the case, then God, Jesus, when he brought his blood, he entered the courtroom and he said, Father, I'm asking you to blot out and expunge that book of works that is under Artie's name and get rid of it for good. And God the Father says, present me the evidence. And Jesus comes with his blood. He said, here you go. Father says, angels, you get rid of that book. You burn it up. There'll never be another record again. Now put his name in the book of life. All because of the blood of Jesus. If it wasn't for his blood, none of us can go to heaven. None of us. Now, there's this syndrome out there that's called, I forgive, but I can't forget. How many of you suffer from that? Don't raise your hand. Everybody's raising their hand. Okay, put your hands down. There's a syndrome out there that's I can forgive, but I can't forget. God doesn't suffer from that. God says, I forgive and I forget. That's powerful. So when you say, I can forgive, but I can't forget, you are really dishonoring the blood of Jesus.
Praise the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. No more of my cousin Vinny stuff. Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10. If you know the story, he goes up and he says, ma'am, I think you're going to need thicker glasses. Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10. Check this out. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1.
Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1. If you're sitting there right now, you should start thinking about your life. Think about how wonderful the blood is, what it's done for you.
listen, some of you, and I'm not pointing anybody out, I don't know all your stories, but some of you have done some really bad things. God took care of it. He took care of everything. There's nothing you have ever done or can ever do that his blood cannot wash away and expunge and blot out for good. Nothing, 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 absolutely nothing. Verse 1, it says, for the law, having a shadow of the good things to come and not the very image of the things, can never, with these same sacrifices, which they offer continually year by year, and make those who approach perfect. For then would they not have ceased to be offered? For the worshipers once purified would have had no more consciousness of sins. But in those sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins every year. He's talking about the Old Testament sacrifices. He said they had to do it every single year, right? And because every single year they were reminded of their sins. Now drop over to verse 12. He says, but this man, after he had offered one sacrifice, say one.
One
sacrifice for sins, forever sat down at the right hand of God. Jesus did it once and for all. He entered the throne room once. He entered hell once. He offered his blood once. I like to tell a story. Once upon a time, Jesus came to earth, took upon his our sins once, hung on the cross once, and died for our sins once, entered hell once, took the keys of death and hell once, rose from the dead once, came into heaven once, and sat down once and for all. That's a great bedtime story. Once upon a time. Now, every single once upon a time story that I know of always ends with, and they lived happily ever after. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Go back to Isaiah. Let me kind of wind this up. You understand why we do communion? That blood is so important to us. I can preach on the blood all day for the next week or 2 weeks if I had to. But I just like to drop some nuggets in here for a little bit. Isaiah, go back to Isaiah 43 a minute, because I want you to see something. Isaiah 43. Isaiah 43, verse 25. Ready? You there? Say amen. If not, say oh my. It says, I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sakes, and I will remember your sins no more. Ready? Verse 26. Put me in remembrance. Let us contend together. State your case that you may be acquitted. In the King James Version, it says it this way. Put me in remembrance. Let us plead together. He says, declare thou that they may be justified. What's God saying? First of all, he says he blots out our transgressions. He forgets them and they're wiped out for good, right? He forgives our iniquities. And he says, now come and plead your case with me. He says, put me in remembrance. In other words, listen, God doesn't forget the blood, but he wants you to make sure you know about the blood. He says, so you put me in remembrance of what I did. Understand this point, because a lot of Christians, a lot of people walk around and thinking God's got their back, everything is cool, I never have to pray, I never have to confess my sin, I never have to repent, I never have to do anything. No, God says, listen, I took care of it, but I want to make sure you remember it. He says, and I want you to put me in remembrance of it, because I want to know how much you know. So when you sin, right? What is 1 John 1:9? He says, confess your sins, and he is faithful and just to forgive you of all your sins and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. Has he dealt with all your sins? Absolutely, once and for all. But he says, now I want you to make sure you remember that. So come and confess.
you plead together. Remind me. So when sick, when COVID, if COVID hits you, what do? I plead my case. Lord, I come to you by the blood of Jesus. And because of that blood, I've been washed, I've been cleansed, I've been healed, I've been delivered, I've been redeemed, I've been made a new creature in Christ. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. I've been made the righteousness of God in Christ. This devil can't touch this. Woo, he can't touch this. He can't have this. He can't touch this because of the blood. Father, I'm just going to remind you because I like to think about the blood. I like to talk about the blood. I like to know that and let the devil know how powerful the blood is, that I have not forgotten what my Jesus did for me on the cross. Can't touch this. Is that how he did it? No. I know it's like this. I don't have the pants with MC Hammer. Nope. And this hip doesn't move as it used to hit. Aha! I plead the blood. I plead the blood. Sister Mary, I plead the blood. I'm not saying Catholic. That's not a Catholic joke. Sister Mary back there. I plead the blood. Father, I'm giving you my last $500. You know it was under my mattress, and I have nothing in the refrigerator right now. But I plead the blood of Jesus. I'm giving this offering from what my heart, and I plead the blood. I put you in remembrance because the blood has caused provision for me. The blood has given me everything I ever needed. The blood washed me clean. The blood does not give me guilt or condemnation. The blood. Woo! Nothing but the blood, the blood, the blood. Genesis chapter 4. We're almost done. Genesis 4. Watch this. Let's finish up with this. Genesis chapter 4. Genesis chapter 4. Everybody knows the story about Cain and Abel, right? Okay. Genesis chapter 4. Cain is their firstborn. Abel is their secondborn. Verse 8, now they come before God with an offering, right? Look at verse 4. Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock of their fat, and the Lord respected Abel and his offering, and did not respect Cain and his offering. Cain was angry in his countenance. Verse 6, so the Lord said to Cain, why are you angry, and why is your countenance fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? If you do not well, sin lies at the door, and the desire is for you, but you should rule over it. Verse 8, ready? Now Cain talked with Abel his brother, and it came to pass when they were in the field that Cain rose up against Abel and his brother and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, where is Abel your brother? He said, I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper? And he said, what have you done? Ready? Underline this, highlight this, make this your scripture on your thing. Watch. The voice of your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Your blood has a voice. Your blood speaks loudly of who you are. Your blood speaks to God right now. Now, let me tell you what God was hearing. He's looking down, right? And he knows Cain killed Abel. He already warned Cain, be careful. Don't do it. Cain kills Abel. Now God walks over to Cain and says, Cain, what did you do? Where's your brother? Now, did God know? Of course he did. He's getting him to confess his sin. He wants him to confess. You understand that principle? God always wants us to confess our sin. He said, what did you do? Remember when he went with Adam and Eve in the cool of the day, right? God walked down. He says, why are you where you're at? What happened to you? Confess your sin. So he speaks to Cain. He says, your brother's blood is speaking to me. And guess what it's saying, Cain? That you did it. Your brother's blood says you're guilty. And he's innocent. Your blood right now is speaking to God and saying, you're guilty. You've got Cain's blood and Abel's blood. Your blood comes from original sin. And it's saying, guess what it's saying? You're guilty. You're guilty. Bishop's guilty. Tubby's guilty. John is real guilty. Always. Listen, our blood is crying out and declaring we're guilty, we're guilty. Abel was saying this, I'm innocent, he's guilty, he did it. And everybody in here, you can point to each other and say, you did it, 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 you're all guilty. Hebrews 11:4, look at this, go Hebrews 11:4, we're gonna hit it home now. Hebrews 11:4. Hebrews 11:4, it says this. Ready? Hebrews 11:4. It says, by faith, Abel offered to God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, through which he obtained a witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gift, and through it, he being dead still speaks. So Abel was basically saying this, his blood was saying, I'm righteous, he's guilty. And that's the cry of everybody right now. You're sitting there saying, God, I didn't do anything, he did it. I'm innocent, he did it. I'm righteous, he did it. Cain, Abel's blood was pointing guilt, guilt, guilt. Now ready for the blood of Jesus? Go to Hebrews 12. Hebrews 12, let's bring this home. Hebrews 12. Ready? Hebrews 12. You there? Verse 22. Listen, one of the worst things I have found about COVID is that they want to know who gave it to you. Who's guilty? I want you to think about that for a while. Contact tracers. We just want to know the spread. No, you want to know who did it. I've listened to people say, I want to know who gave it to me. I want to know who gave it to me. Why? Because you're guilty. Sad world we're living in. Everybody wants it. Well, stay away from me. Now, I'm not trying to put anybody down. But this sense of guilt has been coming out a lot lately. Now watch this. Ready? Hebrews 12:22. But you have come to Mount Zion. Who is it? You guys. And to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to an innumerable company of angels. Talking about us. Ready? You strapped in? You say you're going to be running around the building in a minute. Everybody strapped in? It says, to the general assembly and church of the firstborn. Who's that? It's you. He says, who are registered in heaven to God. Is that you? Yes. To the judge of all, right? And to the spirits of just men made perfect. You've been made perfect. Ready? To Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaks of better things than that of Abel. So notice his blood, Jesus' blood, speaks of better things than that of Abel. So how could you speak of better things than that of Abel? Abel said, we're guilty. Jesus says, you're innocent. Notice what Abel's blood said in Hebrews 11:4. God, I did nothing wrong. Cain's guilty. Jesus came and his blood says, God, I did everything wrong. They're innocent. Better things than that of Abel. Better. His blood speaks. Remember I said blood speaks? His blood speaks. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus' blood is talking right now. Amen. And saying, Lewis, you're innocent. Amen. Art, the verdict is still out on you. You're innocent. Guys, plead your case. Put me in remembrance. When you're feeling about this big,
I can't believe what I did last night. I'm going to church. I'm going to sing. I'm going to get on that platform, but I can't believe I did that last night. I'm not pointing anybody out. No, I'm going to plead the blood. I'm going to put God in remembrance. Lord, you know my flesh is weak. Forgive me of my sin. Thank you that you forget and you remember no more. You just blotted out my sin. I come to the altar this morning and I plead the blood of Jesus, because it speaks of better things than that of Abel. And Jesus, I love you. Thank you for your blood, because your blood declares me innocent right now. I've been made whole. I've been made righteous. I've been made the love of God. I've been made the righteousness of God. I've been made more than a conqueror. I've been made an overcomer, and I will never go under. God has made me the head and not the tail. I'm above and not beneath. I'm going over and I'm not going under. No matter what my bank account looks like, no matter if it says I don't have a job, I'm going over because the blood says so. There's so much in the blood. Thank God for the blood. We take communion as if it's just a ritualistic thing. I don't ever want you to get ritualistic with the blood, with communion. His blood took care of everything. Everything. I need some communion. I didn't get one up here, guys. You can just bring it up. Thank you. Did everybody get today? Everybody get served? John, did you get? Thank you, sir. I want you to think about this. The book of Exodus describes the Passover. Remember the Passover? One of the things that they had to do was take a lamb, bring it in the house. For 4 days, they were to keep the lamb. And then they were supposed to roast it with fire and eat it all. But before that, they had to pour the blood out of the lamb. So they had the flesh, the body, and they had the blood. And the lamb represented Christ the Lamb, the Passover Lamb. And when Jesus came, before he went to the cross, he was beat and whipped and bruised 39 times, 39 lashes on his back. His beard was ripped, his body was broken, and it says his body was broken for the healing of our bodies. And then the night that he was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it. And he said, take, eat, for this is my body, which is broken for you. This represents the healing of our bodies. Father, we put you in remembrance today that Jesus is the healer. And by his stripes, we were healed. And I declare, Father, if there's anyone in this room that has sickness, disease, whether it's COVID or cancer, I declare that by faith, we receive healing together this morning. Strength in our bodies, in Jesus' name. Go ahead and partake. Then they were told to take the blood of the lamb and paint it or pour it on the front of the doorposts, because the angel of death was coming that night. And when the angel of death saw the blood, it would pass over. Jesus went to heaven, poured his blood out. And God the Father looks at that and says, angel of death, you step back from my kids. Because this blood has washed us, cleansed us, removed every record of any wrongdoing that you have ever done. Every thought, every word, every action. The blood is that powerful to remove every occurrence that humanity, one man's blood, took care of sin of billions of people. One man's blood. That's how powerful
this cup represents. This ounce, half ounce of cup of blood represents. It's not blood, but you know what I mean. Father, we thank you and we plead the blood this morning. We put you in remembrance and we remind ourselves, you told us to do this often because it reminds us of the precious blood of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Go ahead and partake. Can we sing that? Stand to your feet.
Precious is the flow.
Go ahead, stand to your feet, please.
White as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the
today, Janice and I are going to get blood test to check our antibodies. Now, the reason why there's antibodies of COVID in our blood is points to a fight that occurred about 50 days ago. Because our bodies fought a fight against the disease. Our bodies won the fight and now created antibodies. So when the doctor sees our blood, it can say, yep, you won the fight. See, the antibodies point to a fight that occurred. On October 7th, my body encountered a fight. And it's funny because it's the words exactly that I used with Janice that night in Vermont is what? What'd I say? My body is fighting something. I knew it. So my antibodies prove I got into a fight and I won the fight. I say that to say this, that whenever you come up to a spiritual battle and you plead the blood, there's antibodies in that blood.
That's right.
Because of a fight that occurred 2,000 years ago.
Hallelujah.
On Calvary. Jesus fought a fight and he won the fight. There's antibodies today available.
Amen.
Because he won the fight.
Amen.
So all you got to do is remind the devil of the fight and declare that there's antibodies in the blood of Jesus. My sin is washed away because there's antibodies against my sin. My healing was paid for because there's antibodies in the blood of Jesus. My poverty was taken care of because there's antibodies in the blood of Jesus. 2,000 years ago, the fight was settled and Jesus won the battle.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So when you plead the blood of Jesus, it reminds the devil of a fight that he lost. And how many of you like to put the devil in remembrance of the fight that he lost? Revelation 12:11 says what? No, yes, go ahead. And it's the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. That's how we overcome. By the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. In other words, when you plead the blood, when you put God in remembrance and you plead the blood, you overcome.
Amen.
Amen. I want you to think about the blood this whole week. Talk about the blood. Sing that song we sang. The blood of Jesus will transform you.
Amen.
Amen. I ask for your face to shine upon them, your grace and mercy to be with them. And I pray the blood would always be on their minds. In Jesus' name, amen. See Lisa over here for cards. Thank you, guys. God bless you. Have a wonderful day. Amen. I plead the blood. I plead the blood.
There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood.